Have you heard of the butterfly effect? The butterfly effect stated that a butterfly could flap its wings on one side of the world and set molecules of air in motion that moved other molecules of air that would eventually move other molecules of air that could eventually create a hurricane on the other side of the planet. The butterfly effect. It was nuts, but it was interesting. Physics professors in the mid-90s proved the butterfly effect was accurate and viable, and it worked every time. And not just with butterflies either. It worked with any form of moving matter, including people.
Respect the Connect, a comprehensive conservation and management plan for Alabama's estuaries and coast, has been the vessel guiding the Mobile Bay National Estuary Program Management Conference in its mission to promote the wise stewardship of the water quality and living resources of our coast. This plan sets out a path for protecting what people value most about coastal Alabama: access to the water and open spaces, healthy beaches and shorelines, abundant fish and wildlife, environmental resilience, heritage and culture, and clean water. The implementation of the CCMP has experienced peaks and valleys, and yet the effects are far greater than any of us expected. Protecting what we value most begins with people consuming knowledge to answer the questions: is the Alabama coast capable of sustaining our quality of life? And how do we make sure it continues to provide what we value most? Keeping track of environmental status and trends is key. In 2006, elected officials of Spanish Fort, Daphne, and Baldwin County initiated a baseline study in the Doleve watershed to determine the source of sediments filling in Lake Forest Lake and Doleve Bay. Excessive loads of dirt had buried what was once a healthy breeding ground for fish and shellfish. The data gathered from this study triggered a more in-depth analysis of the watershed that put in motion a program for restoring ecological and hydrologic functions of the degraded streams. The ultimate goal? Improve conditions in Doleve Bay to support reestablishment of seagrass beds, important nursery areas for fish and shellfish.
The restoration of Doleve watershed was an effort to reduce sediment loads. And the measurement of turbidity allows us to see how much sediment is entering our streams. And these water quality sondes are deployed in 5 locations across the Doleve watershed. And so we're able to see before data and after data from the stream restorations.
We are out sampling the water in Doleve Bay. And we are doing this as the endpoint sampling for a bunch of restoration that's happening further upstream. For a long time, there was not a lot of SAV in here, and they've been doing a lot of restoration, and so we're trying to see how that is affected in Doleve Bay.
In Fall River, disappearing marsh bits in the lower part of the river have concerned some residents for years, and the issue became a priority in the Fall River watershed plan. Considered one of the healthier intertidal watersheds, a sediment study of this area indicated this system was one of the most pristine in the state, leading scientists to wonder, what underlies the degradation of the lower Fall River marsh spits? A team of 8 scientists are now engaged in a comprehensive assessment of the compromised marshes to understand not only what is causing their degradation, but what impact shoreline stabilization measures might have on healthy spits downstream.
It's a multidisciplinary team coming together composed of oceanographers, ecologists, geologists, and basically looking at what we suspect to be 2 problems. Number one, a lack of sediment, and number two, sea level rise.
In particular, this Fowl River is an estuary where we have fresh water at the head and salt water at the mouth. The salt intrusion in this system is something that we're really concerned about.
We can actually look back in time. So what we would do is we'd take deep cores, get a radiometric date of the base of those cores, figure out how much sediment we've accumulated over the time from the base of the core to our current. We get a depositional rate going back to before any humans were here. So if we want to isolate potentially boat wakes as maybe a cause of erosion or loss of sedimentation, we can do a comparison to the past geologic sedimentation rate with the current sedimentation rate to see if there's any differences that maybe we could focus on and address for trying to preserve these point marshes.
The goal of this study is to minimize the unintended consequences of restoration activity. The Dauphin Watershed Management Plan inspired efforts across the bay in the 8 Mile Creek and 3 Mile Creek watersheds. Using NIFWIF Gulf Environmental Benefit funds, by the end of 2017, plans were developed for Fowl River, the Bon Secours River Complex, Dog River, and the Weeks Bay Complex. Planning for the Mississippi Sound Complex is underway, with the Wolf Bay and Appalachian Tensaw Complexes next. As RESTORE funding comes online, plans will be developed to manage all of the remaining estuarine watersheds in the two coastal counties. A plan is one thing, but implementation requires a team that understands the game plan. Consequently, different municipalities and governments have to coordinate to develop new ways to work together to manage resources they share. Watersheds do not follow geopolitical boundaries, and as a result, new ways of managing resources and efforts are needed. In the Dauphin Creek watershed, where problems in one city caused impacts in another, the mayors of Daphne and Spanish Fort and the county commissioner for District 2 regularly meet to discuss coordination of efforts and watershed restoration challenges.
Watershed, aren't aligned and don't follow political boundaries. Mother Nature isn't aware of our political boundaries, and at the end of the day, we're left to deal with those ramifications. The Mobile Bay NEP was instrumental in spearheading efforts to put together an intergovernmental task force. I think everyone recognized there was a problem, but it took leadership in order to bring all the necessary parties to the table in order to address the problem. There's still a number of issues out there to be addressed, and we have a cumulative effect of development and a lack of recognition in addressing some of these stormwater issues. So we're going to have to continue this team approach, and the only way to accomplish that is for us to work together.
To improve coordination of growth-related activities and provide a resource for watershed plan implementation, a new group has emerged.
So the group is the Weeks Bay Watershed Management Planning Group, and generally the purpose was to collaborate across 9 municipalities and the county to be able to plan and improve the coordination of resources and data sharing across those boundaries. And that way there's a better management of watershed resources as well as data compilation and working together to plan across our different areas. So where the watershed's concerned, if we know that this is where our watershed boundary is, or this is an affected area within the watershed, but we know that there's an area that's got some planning or a new subdivision that's being developed, and we want to see how that area could potentially be affected within this watershed management area, now we can have a spatial crossover of seeing what type of information we need to look at further for planning purposes. The county level, municipality level, private firms, everybody took an interest in it because they saw that they were able to use it in multiple different ways for their own needs. Some of these areas that are participating don't have the resources to develop information like this, so it allows us all to work together at a higher level that we haven't been able to do before.
The watershed plan not only facilitated the creation of this group, it recommended the creation of a Baldwin County Watershed Coordinator to oversee and catalyze implementation of the Weeks Bay Plan. Thanks to the Baldwin County Commission and the Baldwin County Soil and Water Conservation District, funding for this position has been secured for the next 3 years. The watershed plan for Three Mile Creek set an ambitious roadmap for environmental restoration of a highly urbanized area within the cities of Mobile and Pritchard. Mobile Mayor Sandy Stimson has led city efforts to implement recommendations of the plan.
If progress is going to be made, if problems are going to be solved, it takes a lot of people to do that. The mayor's task force on Three Mile Creek includes people from the university, from Corps of Engineers, from the city, and from many, many agencies. Everyone who is on the commission is absolutely committed to making sure that we coordinate our effort. But the university has been very concerned about the fact that the stormwater runoff really has been affecting both Three Mile Creek and 12 Mile Creek. And recognizing that, one of the things that we do is try to prevent it. And we've instituted and put in place some bioswales across campus. That will prevent a good portion of the stormwater runoffs. Three Mile Creek it starts here at the university, and so we're absolutely committed to doing what we can to making sure that both here and downstream the creek becomes something that we can be proud of.
The private sector is also stepping up to the plate to champion this urban watershed's transformation.
Our vision is to create a corridor, 12-mile corridor of renewal, transformative renewal along Three Mile Creek from West Mobile to downtown. The Three Mile Creek Partnership is trying to get the business community to really get engaged in this project that will be transformative for the city. But it's really important from an environmental standpoint because so many things impact the creek, from development to stormwater runoff from the city, streets, and, you know, so it's what we're, I think, really trying to do is to let the community know that we have this treasure in many of our backyards. You know, the thing that gets me so excited is you look at a city like Chattanooga, who's put in a 10-mile similar type greenway, or Austin, or on a much larger scale, the Beltline in Atlanta, and without a doubt, it's hard to find a city that hasn't just been transformed by these type projects. It's a huge project. I mean, it's a geographically, it's big, the impact is big, the cost is big. On the community side, you've got 11 neighborhoods along this corridor of various socioeconomic and racial makeups, and so this is a way to bring our city together as a community. You know, if you look around at the state of Alabama, and you know, we have so many assets with all the talk about connecting ecotourism to the Delta and the Bay and, you know, the beaches and all the different watersheds and rivers that we have. So I think that's a big part of this project, showing the next generation that, you know, we do recognize that we have these wonderful, wonderful assets and that we want to take care of them. We want to use them and preserve them, but we also want to make them better. We're very fortunate that this project is finally coming to fruition.
Of everything accomplished this past year, the chrysalis stage is most pronounced in the Coastal Alabama Conservation Corps. Partnering with the MLK Avenue Redevelopment Corporation and the Student Conservation Association, the Conservation Corps was created in response to MLK area residents reintroduced to the wondrous environment in their backyard. Their desire to employ young adults from the area in cleaning up the lower reaches of Three Mile Creek and improving the function of surrounding wetlands. The program started with 10 young men and women with basic training in environmental restoration who were indoctrinated into the world of trashy waters, remote wetland areas, invasive species management, and clogged drainage ways. Their mode of transportation? Canoes. Their charge? Improve environmental conditions in this underserved area. They work through the hottest days of summer, hiking through overgrown brush to eradicate popcorn trees and privet. They cleaned out drainage ways in Toulmin Springs Branch and worked in the Dauphin Watershed, at Graham Creek Reserve in Foley, and along the peninsula of Mobile. They taught their younger peers about the impact trash has on the community, installed rain barrels in flood-prone neighborhoods, and in the coming days will challenge the community at large to do the trash mob. The work was hard, hazardous duty to most. Over the course of 11 months, 10 Corps members became 8, then 6, then 4. For those 4, Eric, Jamarcus, Kevin, and Shayla, their transformation continues, as does the impact of their ripples throughout the community. Throughout coastal Alabama, a metamorphosis is taking place. Resource management by geopolitical boundary is being augmented by watershed-wide coordination. Citizens are educating themselves about environmental issues and taking action. And our ecological systems are being transformed to support ecological function and community growth. If a single butterfly can flap its wings to affect a hurricane far away, a single meeting in Lake Forest can lead to communities across Mobile and Baldwin counties respecting their connection to their watersheds, and to each other, and to the things they value most about living in coastal Alabama.
are generations yet unborn whose very lives will be shaped and shifted by what you do tomorrow and the next day and the next and the next and the next, because everything you do matters.